Learning objective. In this chapter, the user would learn the following in detail. The elements of successful group communication. Types of small groups operating in an organization. Demographic variables that affect group life. The group decision-making process. Tools for effective problem solving. Performing effectively in teams. Managing meeting mania. How to stand out at someone else's meeting. Probing skills. Voice characteristics in articulate speaking. Tone, pitch, rate of speech, and volume. Introduction. Groups are formed to accomplish common goals. The objective of forming a group may be to complete some kind of task or to strengthen the interpersonal relations. Many groups fulfill both functions. While groups like families and clubs are predominantly social in their orientation, work groups function to complete a particular task or solve a particular problem. Communication among group members is very important as it leads to group decisions. If these decisions are to be effective, a group's members must be able to communicate freely and openly with the others. Groups generally develop certain norms for discussion, and group members develop roles that affect the group's interactions. This unit will discuss the factors in group communication, such as size, longevity, leadership, perception, and self-concept and status. It also shows that the stages in group decision making and how to plan for an effective meeting. Demographic variables that affect group life. Demographic traits. There can be various types of members in a team. Team diversity refers to the distribution of personal attributes across members of an organizational work team. Teams are assumed to increase an organization's ability to adapt to dynamic environments. The diversity of member composition in organizational teams has generated considerable interest because of its theoretical and practical importance in the study of task-focused teams in organizations. Team performance is a multidimensional construct that encompasses several outcome measures such as quantitative production, qualitative team outcomes, and team cohesion. One facet of these compositional attributes reflects demographic and work-related diversity among individuals, making it a relevant area for further understanding of inputs that affect team functioning, such as experimenting, admitting mistakes, and seeking feedback. Diversity of age, gender, and race are considered to be the most important demographic factors resulting from team composition. Surface-level diversity reflects differences that are more readily observable. Example, race, gender. Deep-level diversity reflects differences that are less visible. Example, personality, values. The distinction between these two types of surface and deep-level attributes is important because demographic attributes may not be as relevant to a team's given task, but they shape members' perceptions and behaviors. Decision-making. Work teams often seek compliance and consensus in decision-making processes. Although compliance and consensus are often necessary for teams to carry out goals, an overemphasis on consensus-seeking behavior can also result in suboptimal decision-making. Perhaps the most well-known example of this is groupthink, which can arise when groups place too much importance on attaining consensus and fail to debate important alternatives for fear of damaging group cohesion. Creativity and innovation. Organizations are placing a greater emphasis on promoting creativity and innovation as a way to compete in turbulent markets and adapt to environmental uncertainty. In general, the consensus of organizational research has found that member heterogeneity often acts as a conduit for introducing creativity and innovation in teamwork. The effect of diversity on team outcomes is likely to depend on multiple factors. First, the effects of diversity probably depend on the nature of the team's task. Second, the effects of diversity may depend on the particular outcomes studied. Research seems to suggest that diversity may have a positive effect on performance, but a more negative effect on behavioral outcomes such as team member turnover. The inconsistency of the results of research on the impact of diversity in teams on team functioning is due to the focus of most studies on a single characteristic. Age. The ages of individual team members can have considerable effects on the success of a team. As tenure with an organization and age increase, so can performance. Older individuals may contribute more professional expertise, years of experience, and gathered knowledge. However, older team members also tend to be less willing to adapt to evolving work environments and are less likely to implement innovative strategies, preferring instead to stick to tried and true methods. The frequency of meetings and the degree, depth of interactions among members can eventually mitigate adverse outcomes. Team dynamics, the nature and intensity of interactions, and relationships among diverse members can change during teamwork because members tend to integrate and develop a sense of team identity over time. Given the prevalent use of heterogeneous teams in modern workplaces, this quantitative review also provides organizational practitioners with a much-needed empirical corroboration of the benefits of diversity in teams and further demonstrates what forms of team diversity are more important than others with respect to organizational strategic outcomes such as problem solving and innovation. Gender is another important factor of demographic team composition. Men and women differ in their levels of conformity, preference of power distribution, and behavioral norms. In a dictator game setting, it has been found that groups are more generous and egalitarian when women are the majority. They also find that the most generous groups are those with two men and one woman. Another implication of this phenomena is the positive relationship that exists between gender diversity in boardrooms and company performance. However, reverse causality is a pervasive problem in these studies because companies that perform better are quite likely to be companies that also focus more on the gender diversity of their boards. Although teams are routinely assembled from individuals with varying degrees of demographic and cognitive abilities, it is unclear whether such heterogeneous composition leads to groups which outperform homogeneous teams. In particular, the direction and magnitude of effects of team diversity on team outcomes have been an important question that is still not fully understood. Race. Race is the third demographic factor of team composition and has gained additional salience due to the globalization and increasing diversity of the workforce. Within the literature on race and ethnic diversity, there also are some theories that focus on positive predictions or positive outcomes of racial ethnic diversity. This comes from a value in the diversity perspective, which argues that diversity creates value and benefit for team outcomes. The general assumption that underlines these theories is that an increase in racial ethnic diversity means that a work group will experience positive outcomes such as increased information, enhanced problem-solving ability, constructive conflict and debate, increased creativity, high decisions, and increased understanding of different ethnicities, cultures. Another underlying assumption is that surface level diversity such as race is indicative of deeper differences such as cognitive processes, schemas, differential knowledge base, different sets of experiences and different views of the world. Knowledge, skills and abilities, KSAs. KSAs, knowledge, skills and abilities, a list of special qualifications and personal attributes that you need to have for a particular job. These are the unique requirements that the hiring agency wants to find in the person selected to fill a particular job. A primary purpose of KSAs is to measure those qualities that will set one candidate apart from the others. In federal personal guidance, KSAs are defined as the factors that identify the better candidates from a group of persons basically qualified for a position. How well an applicant can show that he or she matches the position's defined KSAs determines whether that person will be seriously considered for the job. Knowledge includes the facts and principles that apply to the domain of the team. Skills can be either basic or cross-functional. Basic skills include developed capabilities that assist in the learning or faster acquisition of knowledge. Cross-functional skills assist in the ability to carry out tasks that occur across jobs. Skills can also be categorized into technical skills, adequate ability to do a variety of jobs, human skills, the ability to interact with others, and conceptual skills, the ability to learn and use newly acquired knowledge. KSAs, why you can't ignore them. Some job applicants, especially those looking for their first federal position, are not sure whether the KSA requirements apply to them or where a response is optional. There's an easy way to decide when to pay attention to KSAs. In a word, always.
Personality. Researchers have considered the effects of individual personality traits on team dynamics and performance to be an important team factor. The most important personality traits include extroversion, conscientiousness, agreeableness, openness to experience, and neuroticism, also called as emotional stability. Relatively little has been done to understand the relationship of the personality of team members to the performance of actual work teams completing production tasks that are additive. Another reason for the lack of cumulative knowledge of all members in relating to personality to actual work team outcomes has been the lack of a generally accepted taxonomy of personality. Consistent with individual level research, team level consciousness appears to be a very potent positive predictor of team effectiveness. The emergence of the five-factor model, FFM, as an understanding medium of personality provides a comprehensive framework from which to examine personality and its relationship to both individual and team performance.
Tenure within a group is an important determinant of group process. Increased tenure is associated with stability, reduced conflict and superior communication. Teams usually have a history and a future, both of which influence current behavior. This highlights the need to assess teams longitudinally, particularly when history and intra-team relationships have a logical connection to the variable of interest. Composition variables related to effective team processes are thought to be particularly important for teams that do multiple tasks. Given that teams are thought to pursue multiple goals over time, it could be that the strength of the composition variable and team performance relationships increases over time. This may be particularly true for personality factors such as team conscientiousness, given that consciousness individuals engage in task role behaviors associated with goal completion, and these behaviors may be even more important when teams pursue multiple goals. How to stand out at someone else's meeting? Number one, try not to interrupt. Interrupting a conversation may make you come across as a blowhard. Number two, don't be a wallflower either. There is a reason why you are invited to a meeting. Make sure you contribute to the conversation. Number three, do some prep work. Have some talking points prepared. Number four, lean in. You'll look more confident and more involved that way. Number five, try to sit across from the most important people in the room. Ensure your presence in the meeting is felt by the who's of the organization. Number six, don't undermine yourself. Phrases like, "This is just my opinion, but," are not your friends. Speak confidently. Number seven, be one of the first people to speak. Be the icebreaker. This will help calm your nerves and you won't have to worry about someone else taking your ideas. Number eight, read the body language. Check often to see if others are distracted or appear uninterested. Maybe it is your cue to pack up. Managing meeting mania. Meeting mania. We have the most ineffective meetings of any company I've ever seen. We have so many meetings, but no decisions ever get made. We just seem to meet and meet and meet, and we never seem to do anything. If these echo your feelings, your organization is caught in the meeting mania trap. This is a common lament. Fortunately, there are some relatively easy steps that you can take to transform meetings from time gobblers to work enhancers. Performance boosters. Use an agenda. Agendas allow the leader to determine whether there is a sufficient cause for calling the group together. Agendas force some degree of planning and inhibit the meeting because it is Tuesday and we have always met on Tuesdays syndrome. When distributed in advance, they give participants enough time to prepare and bring quality thoughts and suggestions to the table. This is particularly important for people who like to cogitate before speaking and whose personal communication style is different from the shoot from the hip, rough and tumble, let's all talk at once style. Start and end on time. Develop a reputation for promptness. The problem with starting late is that it punishes those who did arrive on time. Do not recap for latecomers. By taking extra time to rehash what has gone before, in effect you remove the incentive for people to be on time. Stop when you say you will, and if business is unfinished, calendar it for the next meeting or ask permission to extend for a specific amount of time. Remember, participants often have other commitments scheduled for after the meeting. Performing effectively in teams. Working effectively in a team environment is crucial for many small businesses. It requires skills in effective communication, collaboration, time management, and business acumen. On a team, members share the ownership of meeting the defined objective. By establishing a responsibility matrix, you define who is responsible, accountable, consulted, and informed for each task you complete. Working with a diverse group of people, sometimes in different locations, presents many challenges. Learning to work together effectively in a team environment enables everyone involved to achieve their personal and professional goals. Communication. Effective communication ensures that all team members know what is required of them. By conducting regular meetings and sharing information, the project team manager creates an environment where team members can demonstrate their individual contributions to the effort as well as ask clarifying questions. This minimizes ambiguity and prevents misunderstandings and conflict. To build rapport, an effective project leader conducts team building exercises to foster good communication. For example, play a survival game by asking your team to identify 12 items they would need to survive on a desert island. This exercise helps the group come up with strategies for conducting productive discussions and making decisions. Collaboration. Working in a team environment typically involves collaborating with others to solve problems and develop innovative solutions. Behaving collaboratively includes valuing the contributions of others, brainstorming ideas with team members, and sharing tasks to get work done efficiently. For example, using social media technology, team members can debate alternatives to problems by contributing to wikis, blogs, or forums. Time management. Team members depend on each other to complete tasks according to the plan so that work flows smoothly from one process or task to the next. Effective time management involves prioritizing, scheduling, and focusing on work to maintain productivity. For example, to operate efficiently, team members should assess each task as important or urgent. Important activities typically lead to personal achievement. Urgent activities require immediate attention and may be associated with demands from superiors. By categorizing activities, you can identify distractions and interruptions and minimize them in your schedule in the future. This helps you focus on work that truly contributes to the overall team's goal as well as your personal career objectives. Business acumen. To work effectively on a team, members need to know their role and the overall project objective. Then, they can analyze situations that arise, diagnose the problem, and propose solutions that help the collective team work more effectively towards reaching the goal. This might involve managing a budget, handling risk, making policy decisions, or managing change. To develop skills in business acumen, conduct team building exercises that present scenarios to your team members and give them the opportunity to participate in role-playing activities. For example, divide your team into pairs. Present a challenge relevant to your business, such as dealing with an angry project sponsor who provides funding to the project. Have one person play the role of the sponsor and explain his concerns over an issue, such as a cost overrun. Instruct the other person to play the role of an employee and respond to the issue, such as why the project requires additional resources and funding. This exercise helps employees practice communicating clearly to demonstrate that they truly understand how the business works. 10 qualities of an effective team player. Mentioned below are the top 10 qualities that are required for an effective team player. Number 1. Demonstrates reliability. Counting on a reliable team member who gets work done and does his fair share to work hard and meet commitments. He or she follows assigned tasks. Consistency is the main key. You can count on them to deliver good performance all the time, not just some of the time. Number 2. Communicates constructively. Teams need people who are capable of expressing their thoughts and ideas clearly, directly, honestly, and with respect for others and for the work of the team. This is what it is to communicate constructively. Such a team member does not shy away from making a point, but makes it in the best way possible, in a positive, confident, and respectful manner. Listen actively to what is being said. Good listeners are essential for all teams to function effectively. Teams need team players who can absorb, understand, and consider ideas and points of view from other people without debating and arguing every point. Such a team member also can receive criticism without reacting defensively. Most important, for effective communication and problem solving, team members need the discipline to listen first and speak second so that meaningful dialogue results. Functions as an active participant. Good team players are active participants always. They come prepared for team meetings and listen. They also speak up in discussions. They are fully engaged in the work of the team and do not sit passively on the sidelines. Team members who function as active participants take the initiative to help make things happen, and they volunteer for assignments. Their whole approach is can-do. What contribution can I make to help the team achieve success? Shares openly and willingly. Good team players share. They are willing to share information, knowledge, and experience. They take the initiative to keep other team members informed. Much of the communication within teams takes place informally. Beyond discussion at organized meetings, team members need to feel comfortable talking with one another and passing along important news and information day to day. Good team players are active in this informal sharing. They keep other team members in the loop with information and expertise that helps get the job done and prevents surprises. Cooperates and pitches in to help. Cooperation is the act of working with others and acting together to accomplish a job. Effective team players work this way by second nature. Good team players, despite differences they may have with other team members concerning style and perspective, figure out ways to work together to solve problems and get more work done. They respond to requests for assistance and take the initiative to offer help. Exhibits flexibility. Teams often deal with changing conditions and often create changes themselves. Good team players roll with the punches. They adapt to ever-changing situations. They don't complain or get stressed out because something new is being tried or some new direction is being set. In addition, a flexible team member can consider different points of views and compromise when needed. He or she doesn't hold rigidly to a point of view and argue to death, especially when the team needs to move forward to make a decision or get something done. Strong team players are firm in their thoughts, yet open to what others have to offer. Flexibility at its best. Shows commitment to the team. Strong team players care about their work, the team, and the team's work. They show up every day with this care and commitment upfront. They want to give a good effort and they want other members to do the same. Works as a problem solver. Teams, of course, deal with problems. Sometimes it appears that's the whole reason why a team is created, to address problems. Good team players are willing to deal with all kinds of problems in a solutions-oriented manner. They are problem solvers, not problem dwellers, problem blamers, or problem avoiders. They don't simply rehash a problem the way problem dwellers do. They don't look for others to fault, as the blamers do, and they don't put off dealing with issues the way avoiders do. Team players get problems out in the open for discussion and then collaborate with others to find solutions and form action plans. Treats others in a respectful and supportive manner. Team players treat fellow team members with courtesy and consideration, not just some of the time but consistently. In addition, they show understanding and the appropriate support of other team members to help get the job done. They don't place conditions on when they will provide assistance, when they will choose to listen, and when they'll share information. Good team players also have a sense of humor and know how to have fun, and all teams can use a bit of both. But they don't have fun at someone else's expense. Quite simply, effective team players deal with other people in a professional manner. Probing skills. Probing is asking follow-up questions when we do not fully understand a response, when answers are vague or ambiguous, or when we want to obtain more specific or in-depth information. For example, what did you like best about the program? Probing questions often begin with what or how, because they invite more detail. Questions that begin with do you or are you invite personal reflection. Why? Questions can be problematic. They may put the respondent on the defensive or result in little useful information and require additional probing. Example, why did you do that? Because I wanted to. If possible, try to replace why with what. With any question, watch for leading questions or bias in your probes. An effective way of probing is to use the 5 whys method, which can help you quickly get to the root of a problem. Takichi Toyoda, one of the fathers of the Japanese Industrial Revolution, developed the technique in the 1930s. He was an industrialist, inventor, and founder of Toyota Industries. His technique became popular in the 1970s, and Toyota still uses it to solve problems today. Toyota has a go and see philosophy. This means that its decision making is based upon an in-depth understanding of the processes and conditions on the shop floor, rather than reflecting what someone in a boardroom thinks might be happening. The 5 whys technique is true to this tradition, and it is most effective when the answers come from people who have hands-on experience of the process being examined. It is remarkably simple. When a problem occurs, you uncover its nature and source by asking why no fewer than 5 times. Here it is in action. Each time you ask why, look for an answer that is grounded in fact. It must be an account of things that have actually happened, not events that might have happened. This prevents the 5 whys becoming just a process of deductive reasoning, which can generate a number of possible causes and sometimes create more confusion. Keep asking why until you feel confident that you have identified the root cause and can go no further. At this point, an appropriate countermeasure should become evident. The 5 whys strategy is an easy to use, effective tool for uncovering the root of a problem. You can use it in troubleshooting, problem solving, and quality improvement initiatives. Start with the problem and ask why it is occurring. Make sure that your answer is grounded in the fact, then ask why again. Continue the process until you reach the root cause of the problem and you can identify a countermeasure that prevents it recurring. Bear in mind that this questioning process is best suited to simple to moderately difficult problems. The elements of successful group communication. Groups are formed to accomplish common goals. The objective of forming a group may be to complete some kind of task or to strengthen their interpersonal relations. Many groups fulfill both functions. While groups like families and clubs are predominantly social in their orientation, work groups function to complete a particular task or solve a particular problem. Communication among group members is very important as it leads to group decisions. If these decisions are to be effective, a group's members must be able to communicate freely and openly with the others. Groups generally develop certain norms for discussion, and group members develop roles that affect the group's interactions. Size. The size of a group plays a major role in group communication. Members of a smaller group can communicate better with each other than members of a larger group who have fewer opportunities to interact with each other. Longevity. The interrelationships among the group members depend on whether the group's nature is short-term or long-term. Groups formed for short-term goals, like those going on a tour, usually focus more on the task at hand rather than on maintaining interpersonal relationships. Groups formed for long-term assignments, on the other hand, may devote a lot more time to maintaining relationships among members. Leadership. A leadership that aims at achieving task goals while maintaining interpersonal relationship within the group accounts for greater group success. Perception and self-concept. Each member of a group generally has his or her own perception about how the group should function, what kind of goals it should have, and how it should work towards it. At the same time, he or she also has a self-concept which determines how he or she will interact with others in the group. The successful working of a group depends to a great extent on its ability to satisfy the expectations and support the self-concept of its members. Status. Sometimes, a few members of a group have a better social standing or are better qualified than the others. The status of the members determines the manner in which they interact with each other. People tend to communicate with peers as their equals, but they tend to speak upward to superiors and downward to subordinates.
The group decision-making process. Research has shown that groups generally have a predictable pattern in arriving at decisions. Having an effective group decision-making process can be a major source of productivity improvement for your organization. Some surveys show that nearly 50% of participants consider unfocused projects and meetings as the primary source of lost time and workday productivity. Many of these meetings support group decision-making activities. Any improvement in the group decision-making process increases value generated from a decision while simultaneously improving organizational productivity.
There are four stages in group problem solving. A. The orientation stage. When group members get to know each other, the communication at this stage is rather tentative. The norms that govern the interactions between the group members are usually formed at this stage. B. The conflict stage. When members disagree with each other and debate ideas. C. The emergent stage. When members reconcile their differences and the outcome of the group's efforts and the group's social structure become apparent. D. The reinforcement stage. When group members endorse the final decision by using supportive verbal and non-verbal communication. Though the general purpose of a group is to achieve specific goals or take decisions, different groups can follow different approaches to meet their purpose. Some common approaches are reflective thinking. Developed by John Dewey, this is a careful, systematic approach to problem solving. This approach involves 6 steps. 1. Problem identification. 2. Problem analysis. 3. Criteria selection. 4. Solution generation. 5. Solution evaluation and selection. And 6. Solution implementation. Brainstorming. Sometimes brainstorming sessions are used to arrive at a decision. During brainstorming, members generate as many ideas about a topic as they can. Every idea is recorded without being evaluated. No idea is rejected at the initial stage. The group then returns to the ideas and adopts those that seem most feasible or most useful. Nominal group technique. This is a group decision-making tool used to rank a set of options. Members individually list all options that can be considered. The group facilitator then asks each member to rank all the options from the lowest to the highest priority. The facilitator then commutes an average score to each idea to determine the group's highest priority. The final decision. There are many ways that a group can use to arrive at a final decision, agree on a solution, or come to an agreement. Some of the popular ways of making decisions include consensus. All the group members agree on the final decision after discussion and debate. Compromise. Group members come to an agreement by giving up some of their demands. Majority vote. The decision is based on the opinion of the majority of its members. Decision by leader. The group allows its leader to take the final decision. Facilitating group decision-making activities and discussions. When dealing with larger groups, an effective group decision-making process should address how group interactions will be managed and facilitated. This should be addressed in initial planning to ensure that the benefits of group contribution and coordination can be gained at all appropriate steps in the decision-making process. Good facilitation can avoid inadequate exchange of relevant information and process losses that are characterized by the meeting surveys mentioned in the opening paragraph. Group facilitation or coordination should aim to motivate people to perform joint work, provide goal clarity, structure group discussions, and provide explicit coordination where mechanisms are clearly and intentionally described to eliminate any misunderstanding in intention. Supply information to establish common understanding, such as definition of key terms, and promote appropriate sharing. Provide mechanisms for information storage, retrieval, sharing, summarizations, and repetition. Establish the communication channels needed to satisfy task complexity needs.
Tools to support the group decision-making process. There are a lot of tools that can provide significant support for the process by addressing many of the needs identified above. Group decision-making techniques are facilitated using a lot of methods and often incorporate methods of combining individual responses into proven decision-making techniques such as Multiple Criteria Decision Analysis, MCDA. For large groups, complexity in managing communications and tasks can be facilitated with project management tools currently in use within the organization. Once the group decision-making process has been defined for the specific decision, look for a tool or tools that will address specific needs for determining participation level, facilitating group communication, sharing information, combining group input, managing tasks, applying the agreed decision-making techniques or techniques, recording decision information, and providing needed reports.
tone, pitch, rate of speech, and volume. Your voice is the link between you and your listeners. It is the primary medium for conveying your message. What kind of voice do you have? Is it rich, exciting, and easy to listen to? All speakers should work to develop a voice that enhances their words and attracts listeners' attention. A good speaking voice has several qualities. It is pleasant, conveying a sense of friendliness. Natural, reflecting the true personality and sincerity of the speaker. Forceful, conveying vitality and strength even when it isn't especially loud. Expressive, demonstrating various shades of meaning, never sounding monotonous and emotionless. Easily heard, as a result of proper volume and clear articulation. If listeners can't hear you, or if they find your voice annoying, they will not pay attention and your message will be lost.
The role of posture and breathing. A good quality voice begins with good breathing. Your voice is supported by a column of air. The depth and steadiness of this air affects your voice. You'll find that breathing deeply from your abdomen or lower chest will provide better vocal quality than breathing shallowly from your upper chest. Abdominal breathing will help you manage your breathing as you speak. Inhale during logical pauses in your speech before you run out of air. Then release the air slowly so you don't run out of air or lose projection after the first few words. Posture has a great impact on your voice. Air must flow freely through your lungs and vocal cords. If you slouch when speaking, with your shoulders hunched and your head down, your lungs and vocal cords are blocked and airflow is reduced. For maximum control of your breath and voice when you speak, stand straight, knees slightly flexed, head straight and shoulders back.
Characteristics of a good voice. A good speaking voice should be balanced between extremes of volume, pitch, rate and quality. Volume. Being able to control the loudness or softness of your voice helps to keep the audience's attention. Speaking too loudly for a long time will bother your audience. Speaking too softly for a long time will annoy listeners too, as they struggle to grasp your words. Volume level depends on the size and shape of the room. However, you should also vary your volume level for emphasis. For example, if you are conveying anger, you will want to increase your volume. If you are sharing something secretive with the audience, lower the volume. Pitch. The pitch of a sound is how high or low it is on the musical scale. Vary your pitch as you speak. Droning on in a monotone voice will quickly put listeners to sleep, and speaking in a squeaking voice will make them want to cover their ears. You should adapt the pitch of your voice to the material you are presenting. For example, a high pitch conveys excitement and enthusiasm, while a low pitch indicates sadness or thoughtfulness. Rate. This is the number of words you speak per minute. Speak too fast and your audience will not be able to keep up with you. Speak too slowly and your listeners will lose interest. You want to speak fast enough so that people have to pay attention, but slow enough that they can digest what you are saying. The most effective speaking rate is approximately 125 to 160 words a minute. You should vary the rate, moving quickly through some of the material, but slowly to emphasize important information or to communicate a complex idea. Quality. Your voice should convey friendliness, naturalness and confidence and be enjoyable and pleasant to the ears. Listen to yourself on tape. Does your voice sound harsh, breathy, shrill, thin or nasal? You can improve it by relaxing, eliminating any tension from your voice. Silence can be golden. At times you won't want to use your voice. Well-timed silences or pauses add impact to your words and are a powerful speaking technique. A pause can be used to emphasize your main points. A moment of silence before a statement tells listeners that you are about to say something important. A brief pause after you make a statement tells listeners that what you just said is important. Breathe. Appropriate pauses are your opportunity to inhale. Punctuate. Pauses often serve as punctuation, telling listeners that you have ended a sentence or thought. Attract attention. When you feel that listeners are distracted, pause. Your silence will attract their attention back to you. Be expressive. Your voice should be expressive, showing a wide range of emotion. An expressive voice adds more meaning to the words you use, enhances your message, and adds interest for your audience. Read these passages aloud using the tone of voice appropriate to each. I appreciate all you have done for me, and I hope to return the favor someday. Simple, honest statement or sarcasm. Kindness. Do you call that kindness? I wouldn't treat a stray dog the way you have treated me. Resentment, anger, unfriendliness. If each of us do one kind of thing for someone else every day, we could help make the world a better place to live. Deep feeling of earnestness and conviction. The value of rehearsal. Like body language, your speaking voice should be natural and consistent with the meaning of the words being spoken. Achieving a speaking voice that is comfortable for you and enjoyable for the audience takes thought and practice. After you have drafted your speech, read it and note any places where you can vary the rate, pitch, volume, and vocal quality, or pause to add emphasis and meaning. Speak clearly and project your voice. Try several different methods to see which one is most effective. Match vocal variety to your words. You should be compelled to change your voice when your thought or words require it. Don't worry if at first your efforts at local variety are awkward. The more you rehearse your speech and become familiar with your voice, the more comfortable you will become. If you have access to a tape recorder, use it in rehearsals to help you improve. Tools for effective problem solving. The problems faced can be large or small, simple or complex, and easy or difficult to solve. Regardless of the nature of the problem at hand, a fundamental part of every employee's role is finding ways to solve them. Having tools to solve problems and being a confident problem solver is important to your success. Problem-solving tools are determined by the requirements of the problem and the amount of time to solve the problem. There are four basic steps in problem solving. Number one, defining the problem. Number two, generating alternatives. Number three, evaluating and selecting alternatives. Number four, implementing solutions. Step 1. Understanding the problem. The key to a good problem statement is ensuring that you deal with the real problem, not its symptoms. Use tools to help you ask the right questions and work through the layers of a problem to uncover what's really going on. It is also important to ensure that you look at the issue from a variety of perspectives. If you commit yourself too early, you can end up with a problem statement that's really a solution instead. Step 2. Understanding complex. When your problem is simple, the solution is usually obvious and you don't need to follow the four steps we outlined above. A complex problem is likely to be complex when it is difficult to understand due to the web of interrelated issues. On a more complex problem, you will typically take a more formal approach to solve your problem. The good news is that there are numerous tools you can use to make sense of a complex problem. The problem-solving possibilities diagram will help to assist you in determining what tools would work best. Problem-solving possibilities diagram. Brainstorming. Brainstorming is a group process that involves the spontaneous contribution of ideas from all members of the group. This is one of the most widely used decision-making strategies. Sometimes brainstorming sessions are used to arrive at a decision. During brainstorming, members generate as many ideas about a topic as they can. Every idea is recorded without being evaluated. No idea is rejected at the initial stage. The group then returns to the idea and adopts those that seem most feasible or most useful. Generating ideas in a brainstorming session. Appoint one person to record the ideas that crop up in the session. These should be noted in a format that is easy for everyone to see and refer. Depending on the approach one wants to use, they may want to record ideas on flip charts, whiteboards, or computers with data projectors. If people aren't already used to working together, consider using an appropriate warm-up exercise or an icebreaker. Define the problem you want solved clearly and lay out any criteria to be met. Make it clear that the objective of the meeting is to generate as many ideas as possible. Give people plenty of time on their own at the start of the session to generate as many ideas as possible. Ask people to give their ideas, making sure that you give everyone a fair opportunity to contribute. Encourage people to develop other people's ideas or to use other ideas to create a new one. Encourage an enthusiastic, uncritical attitude among members of the group. Try to get everyone to contribute and develop ideas, including the quietest members of the group. Ensure that no one criticizes or evaluates ideas during the session. Criticism introduces an element of risk for group members when putting forward an idea. This stifles creativity and cripples the free-running nature of a good brainstorming session. Let people have fun brainstorming. Encourage them to come up with as many ideas as possible, from solidly practical ones to widely impractical ones. Encourage creativity. Ensure that no train of thought is followed for too long. Make sure that you generate a sufficient number of different ideas as well as exploring individual ideas in detail.
Brain writing. Brain writing is another concept where idea generating technique that is similar to brainstorming, except that instead each participant thinks and records ideas individually and it is done in silence. This method often creates some breakthrough ideas as people build on the ideas of others. Participants write down ideas and then share with group members to stimulate new ideas. It works best with small groups of 5 to 9 people. Just like in traditional brainstorming, you also need a moderator for the session.
Affinity diagram. An affinity diagram is a tool that gathers large amounts of ideas, opinions, and issues and sorts them into categories based on their natural relationships. Step 1. Generate ideas. Brainstorm to get a list of ideas and have a recorder. Write them on flip chart paper or have each person individually write their own ideas on post-it notes or note cards. Step 2. Display the ideas. If ideas were written on flip chart paper, transfer them to post-it notes. Place post-it notes randomly on a wall or on blank pieces of flip chart paper. Step 3. Sort the ideas into related groups. Team members sort the post-it notes or note cards into groupings using the following process. This can be done as a group or team members can do this individually. Start by looking for two ideas that seem related in some way. Place them together in a column off to one side. Look for ideas that are related to those already set aside and add them to that group. Look for other ideas that are related to each other and establish new group. This process is repeated until the team has placed all of the ideas in the group. Decision matrix. A decision matrix evaluates and prioritizes a list of options. The team first establishes a list of weighted criteria and then evaluates each option against those criteria. A decision matrix may also be called POOG matrix, decision grid, selection matrix or grid, problem matrix, problem selection matrix, opportunity analysis, solution matrix, criteria rating form, criteria based matrix. Step 1. Generate ideas. Brainstorm the evaluation criteria appropriate to the situation. Step 2. Discuss and refine the list of criteria. Identify any criteria that must be included and any that must not be included. Reduce the list of criteria to those that the team believes are most important. Step 3. Draw an L-shaped matrix. Write the criteria along one edge and the other criteria along the other edge. Step 4. Evaluate each choice against the criteria. Writing each choice on a post-it will help the team to discuss each choice and move it within the matrix if necessary. Other tools include process maps, Kaizen events, etc. Types of small groups operating in an organization. Within many organizations, different groups are formed at different levels: formal groups, informal groups, primary groups, and secondary groups. Some groups may be deliberately formed. Some groups are formed through an informal setting. Below we discuss briefly four forms of groups which are found within a company. Types of groups: formal group, informal group, secondary group, and primary group. Formal group. A formal group is created within an organization to complete a specific role or task. This may be one-off objective, such as the launch of a particular product or service, or a permanent ongoing objective, such as the provision of information technology. Informal group. Informal groups are established by individuals who decide they want to interact with each other. Informal groups usually do not have a specific purpose. Often the group forms because the group members regularly happen to be in the same location or because they enjoy each other's company. For example, people may form a group because they sit close together in an office or live together in a house. Primary group. A primary group is made of a small set of people who interact regularly. A small team with a leader is an example of a primary group. A family can also be called a primary group. Certain values, beliefs, and culture are very important within a primary group. Secondary group. When a large number of people get together who do not normally get together, it is called a secondary group. Secondary group members do not get the opportunity to get to know each other as well as primary group members, because the interaction with each other is less than in a primary group. When a secondary group is formed, individuals usually have their own agenda and goals. The relationship they form is not long-term, and social interaction within a secondary group is likely to be low. Voice characteristics in articulate speaking. Being articulate gives people the impression of a solid, full education and cultured mind. It will make people more likely to listen to you and to respect your intelligence. Whether you're giving a presentation or trying to tell your best friends a funny story, if you make an effort to think before you speak and to be more clear and concise on a regular basis, then you will be the most articulate person in the room in no time. Know your subject. Speak on matters where you are able to bring more clarity to others or help add to the discussion. Speaking from a desire to add something or just get your voice heard will not add to your perceived level of articulationness. Let others speak about things that they are an expert in and add to that discussion through articulate questions. Do your research and know the alternative perspectives, but be willing to quit sharing when you move outside your current knowledge. If you don't know your subject well, but have to speak on it, then extensive research will help you sound like you know your stuff. The term articulation refers to how distinctly you formulate your words when you speak. It includes both how you pronounce individual words and how clearly you create speech sounds. Your speaking voice pronunciation is the formation and utterance of words. It is the product of correct sounds in the sequence of a word. Mispronunciation, on the other hand, is the failure to produce the correct sounds. For example, just, gist, asked, axed, length, length, going to, gonna, etc. Enunciation relates to the fullness and clarity of speech sounds. Pronunciation and enunciation combine to form the basis of articulation or the shaping of sounds by the tongue, teeth, palate, lips, and nose. Clear articulation requires three conditions. 1. The sound must be accurately formed. 2. The sound must be sufficiently supported by the breath. 3. The sound must be completely finished. Do you trudge like a turtle or race like a rabbit? The rate at which you speak is closely associated with your personality. Consequently, rate is difficult to change because it relates to how you think and behave, how you live your life. Yet, you should avoid speaking either too slow or too fast because either can distort your articulation, limit changes of pitch, and alter your voice quality. A slow speaker may not realize how listeners must struggle to pay attention. People think at a much faster rate than the flow of speech. An overly slow speech encourages listeners to daydream. In addition, it often results in sound distortion and lack of variety, which can make what you say incomprehensible. Talking too fast creates a similar problem. When information is spewed forth at a rapid rate, listeners become frustrated and stop paying attention. Do you agitate or orchestrate? People speak in musical notes. A good speaker may use as many as 25 different notes to convey variety and meaning. A one-note speaker is tedious to an audience and promotes inattention and boredom. Vocal variety is the way you use your voice to create interest, excitement, and emotional involvement. It is accomplished by varying your pitch, volume, and timing. Inflections comprise another important characteristic of speaking. An inflection is a raised pitch, a high note used to add emphasis to a word. How to improve your speaking voice? 1. While standing or sitting comfortably, place your hands lightly on your throat muscles and speak in a normal tone. Note the tenseness of the throat muscles and the tightness of your jaw. Number 2. Yawn. Open your mouth wide. Finish the yawn with an easy oh hum, prolonging the hum for several seconds. Drop your jaw as far as it will go without stress. Waggle the jaw from side to side and continue humming with your lips closed and jaw loose. Number 3. Repeat the yawning and humming. Notice how your throat muscles have loosened and become relaxed. See how comfortable your throat feels with the strain removed. Number 4. Retaining this feeling of ease and looseness, say the following words. Hang, harm, lane, main, lone, loom. Open your mouth wide, dropping your jaw loosely. Exaggerate your lip and jaw movements. When your throat feels tired, stop and yawn again. Number 5. Lightly knead the throat muscles with your fingers to eliminate tightness. Warning. Voice exercises should be done in brief stints, 5 minutes or less, and spaced throughout the day. If your voice tires or your throat feels rough or scratchy, you are probably overdoing the exercises or doing them incorrectly. Number 6. Slowly repeat the following sounds na, ne, ni, no, nu. Drop your jaw and relax your throat. Prolong the sounds, giving each equal length. Extending and controlling your pitch. Most speakers talk on too high a pitch. A thin, high-pitched tone lacks authority and appeal and is often harsh and unpleasant. Cultivate deeper tones. Be careful not to develop too low a pitch, which results in rumbling, indistinct, ponderous speech. We each have a natural pitch on which we speak. It may or may not be good. If your natural pitch needs to be lowered, work on it by consciously pitching your voice lower in all conversation. Change it a half tone at a time. Speaking with careful enunciation and in a relatively soft tone will help you to establish the change. Conclusion. In this chapter, we have covered the following in detail. The elements of successful group communication. Types of small groups operating in an organization. Demographic variables that affect group life. The group decision-making process. Tools for effective problem solving. Performing effectively in teams. Managing meeting mania. How to stand out at someone else's meeting. Probing skills. Voice characteristics in articulate speaking, tone, pitch, rate of speech, and volume.